So once again, good morning, everybody. Welcome to this Thanksgiving and more service. We'll know more about the more later on. So the service will start after we just have this reflective few seconds of music. Amen. Shall we pray? Father, we thank you that we have once again the privilege to gather together, yet in our various homes, just to worship you, to glorify you. We thank you for another new month. We thank you that we have seen the beginning of May, and we'll see the end of it. We thank you for health and strength. We just bring this service to you, Lord, and we ask, O Lord, that in the way you speak to each and every one of us individually, that there will be something in this service that will minister to us, that there will be in this service, there will be an answer to a questioning, a confirmation of what you have been saying, a prayer that confirms what we have been praying about, and a revelation and an insight that will help us in our tomorrow. We ask for all these things, Lord, to each and every one of us and to everyone who will listen and who is listening to this service. In Jesus' name, amen. It's a Thanksgiving service. So it's a bit not too different from what we normally have. And the theme of today's service is reasons for your thankfulness. Reasons for your thankfulness. One of the reasons for our thankfulness is what we are currently studying on Wednesday in the book of Joseph. We've come across this phrase that what the enemy meant for evil, God will turn for your good. What the enemy meant for evil, God will turn for your good. Not just once or twice, but all the time. God will always turn everything that the enemy meant for evil against you. God will always turn it for your good. So the service theme is reasons for thankfulness, and as we go through it, I want you to get into it. This service is more about equipping us for tomorrow, equipping us for the coming month, equipping us for the coming week. Yes, it's about celebration and thanking God, but also it's about also equipping us for the days and the weeks ahead. And so we start with the reason to be thankful. And that is reflected in the rescue story.
There you were in the shadows, holding out your hand, you met me there. And now where would I be without you? Where would I be, Jesus? You were the voice in the desert, calling me out in the dead of night. You are never gave up on me. You were my testimony. Oh, you never gave up on me. You never gave up on me. You were my testimony. Oh, you never give up on me. Oh, you never give up on me. Oh, this is my testimony. Oh, you were a voice in the desert, calling me out in the dead of night, fighting my battles for me. You were my rescue story, lifting me up from the ashes, carrying my soul from death to life, bringing me from glory to glory. You were my
Jesus is our rescue story. Others may give up on us, but Jesus will never give up on us. And that's a reason to be thankful. We should be thankful because we should be thankful that Jesus Christ died for your sins. He willfully suffered the full extent of God's wrath that you and I may live. We give him nothing, and all we do is take. But he gave his life for ours. This is true love. So we thank God for our only claim to heaven, our beloved Savior, Jesus Christ. Many of us have come to situations where we saw God turn it around. So we thank God for turning it around. We thank God for bringing life where there has been death for so long. We thank God for the rattling of the dry bones.
make a dead man walk again. Open the grave, I'm coming out. I'm gonna live again. This is the sound of dry bones rattling. Rattling.
That the dry bones and all those things that have represented dry bones in our lives will hear the sound of the Almighty that says, live and live again. I pray life into all that was ours but has been dried up. All the promises that have frozen up and have felt so dry and dead. I speak to them and I say, live and live again. And we shall give thanks to the Lord for the turnaround. We shall give thanks to the Lord for the turnaround. We shall give thanks to the Lord for the turnaround. the reason to be thankful. Be thankful that God has provided you with food. It might not be white truffles and gold pizza at Margo's, a restaurant that costs £2,000 a plate. But always remember that some people are eating mud pies. And they were born of a woman just like you. Reasons to be thankful. We thank God for His goodness. And all around us we see, and we have in our personal lives, we have seen the evidence of His goodness. So we thank the Lord for His goodness.
All throughout my history, Your faithfulness has walked beside me. The winter storms made way for spring. In every season, from where I'm standing, I see the evidence of Your goodness all over my life, all over my life. I see Your promises in fulfillment all over my life, all over my life.
Father, we see the evidence of your goodness in our lives. There are many times when we have been in tough situations, when we thought we could not survive it, when we thought what we could not even live one more day, when the thought of the week, the thought of tomorrow has brought fear into us, and we have seen you time and time again come to our rescue. We have seen you time and time again come to our rescue. So, Father, we thank you for those days that we thought would never end, but you brought us through. So this morning, we give thanks to you. We recognize the evidence of your goodness, the evidence of your faithfulness. Right from the biggest, in Christ who died for us, to the smallest, our ever small desires. Thank you, Father. Thank you, Lord, because we have prayed in Jesus' name. Amen. Today's message is different. I'm not preaching this morning. I was preparing and then I realized that I'm not preaching. So the person who is going to speak to us this morning is somebody who many of us don't know. I don't know him as well, apart from the fact I know of him. But I'm sure by the time he finished preaching, you will go out in search of him. So today's message is coming from, is the title of the message is How to Thank God Even Though by Pastor Steven Furtick. Pastor Steven is an American pastor and a songwriter, and is the lead, is the head pastor or senior pastor of the Elevation Church. And anybody who is into music, you'll know about the Elevation Worship. We just listened to him this morning, and he talks about, because we're talking about thanks, being thankful. He says, how to thank God even though. And that's where many of us would like to be, the ability to thank God even though. Let's just listen to Pastor Steve.
You graduate from just an attitude of gratitude to a way of life that is grateful. You say, thank you, Lord. Yet to really graduate from the kiddie table, because I don't know about you, but I don't want to sit in this seat the rest of my life. I don't want to be the kind of Christian who only thanks God when he's serving me. I don't want to be a grown man talking about, this is the table called thanks, where I thank him for his provision. But to graduate, touch somebody, say, it's time to graduate. It's time to graduate. It's time to graduate. To graduate, we need David, because Moses was teaching the people to relate to God on the provision level. David was a little bit different because of his experience. He was raised up as a shepherd in Jesse's house to be king anointed by Samuel. He had a remarkable ability to remember where he came from, and it always made him thankful and made him grateful. Even though his life was very dysfunctional, he was driven by a sense of returning to God who had given all the blessings to him. And David comes in to give us a deeper understanding of mature gratitude. It's not mature gratitude to thank God for what he's given you. That's just manners. That's just good manners. That's just politeness. So David comes along, he says, I want to move you from the kiddie table to the banquet table. Bring out the banquet table. David, who was not only a subject of the king, but a king of the people, had spent some time as a shepherd. And so while Moses is teaching the people to relate to God on the most basic level, when he blesses you, remember him. When he blesses you, obey him. When he keeps his covenant with you, keep his commands that it may go well with you. This is basic. David steps in and takes it a little bit deeper. Let's go deeper. David says, "The Lord is my shepherd. I shall not want. He makes me lie down in green pastures. He leads me beside still waters." Have you heard this before? Maybe you heard it at a funeral. Maybe you heard it in a time of mourning. David wrote it in a valley. Yet he says something interesting in Psalm 23. And this takes us to the next level of praise. Psalm 23, verse 4. He says, "Even though I walk through the darkest valley, I will fear no evil, for you are with me, your rod and your staff, they comfort me." Moses teaches us how to thank God for the. But David comes along and teaches us how to thank God even though. Even though. Even though. This is a graduated form of gratitude. This is the remedial level. Thank you for the. But this is the place where you learn to praise God even though. Even though. This is where you can have all hell breaking loose in one area of your life, but say, "It is well with my soul when peace like a river attendeth my way, when sorrows like sea billows roll." Whatever my life, you have taught me to say, "It is well, even though my heart is broken. It is well, even though I lost some people. It is well, even though I'm going through. It is well, even though." This is the table where you learn to thank God for what you can see. This is the table where you learn to trust God with what you cannot. Even though I walk through the darkest valley. Now, church, it's one thing for Professor Moses to tell us, "Thank God for the good land." But now we got to decide what kind of Christians we want to be. Are we only going to thank him for the food? Are we only going to thank him for the finances? Are we only going to thank him for the fiance? Or are we going to thank him even though I'm single? Where you want to sit? Am I only going to thank him when I can see the evidence of his presence? Even though recognizes his presence in the presence of enemies. This is the stage of praise where you're no longer thanking God for his provision only. Oh, you carry that over. You're still grateful for the provision. That's a starting place. But now I'm thanking him for his presence. You're gonna need this. If you wanna be a big boy and you don't wanna be a baby, you're gonna have to sit in this seat and learn to eat with enemies all around you. Can you keep your eyes fixed on the presence of God in the presence of your enemies? Because at this table, David said, God isn't the only one seated. I got enemies all around me. You prepare, verse 5, a table for me in the presence of my insecurity, in the presence of my deficits, in the presence of my addictions, in the presence of my confusion, in the presence of what I've lost, in the presence of the threat that I won't make it, in the presence of my enemies, I'm looking straight ahead. Woo! Would you do me a favor? Would you touch the person next to you and tell them, set the table? Because when you learn to have a heart of praise in the presence of enemies, you set the table. That's what David said, right? You prepare a table for me in the presence of my enemies. And if you can walk with God in darkness enough, depending on the light that he showed you in the last season, you'll learn to read your enemies as a sign that it's time to eat. Yes, sir. David said, God made my enemies serve me my entree. God made the things that conspired to take me out feed me for the place he was bringing me into. I got a seat at the table. I'm a big boy. I can handle trouble. I can handle tests. I can handle it. So I'm sitting down in the middle of all kinds of nonsense, but I got my eyes fixed on the presence of the one who is within me. And greater is he that is in me. Woo. Wouldn't it be great if you could turn the tables on your fear today? And make the thing that was coming after you serve the purpose of God in your life. David said, you can do it. You can do it. If you can eat in the presence of enemies. If you can be blessed under the weight of burdens. If you don't always need me to bring it up to the table and set it before you. But if you can say, see, when I praise God through pain. Everybody shout, even though. No, shout it like you want the devil to hear. Even though you came at me, I'm still standing. Even though you set an ambush against me. Even though you tried to make me born kind of wild. I'm still sitting at the table. And when you praise him in pain, it is preparation for provision. If you can keep your seat.
Hey, thank you for watching. Make sure you subscribe to this channel so you don't miss a single video or live stream. And share this video with a friend. And don't forget, you can join me live every Sunday. Thanks again for watching.
Amen. Amen. I cannot say anymore. I cannot add to what he has said. I hope we got the message. Now we have communion.
Thank you, Father, for loving us so much. You gave us your only begotten beloved Son, in whom you are well pleased, Jesus Christ. Thank you for sending him to die for us on the cross, to reconcile us to you, Lord. Father, we ask that you set apart and make holy our communion elements in Jesus' name.
Amen.
Amen. Thank you, Lord Jesus, for allowing your body to be broken for us on the cross. Your word tells us that surely by your stripes we are healed. We believe your word. And we receive our healing in Jesus' name. Amen. Thank you, Lord Jesus, for shedding your blood for us on the cross. Thank you, Lord, that through your blood we have forgiveness of sins. Through your blood, we have the free gift of righteousness. Your blood is the confirmation of the new covenant we have with God the Father. The covenant that tells us that you will be merciful to all of our unrighteousness, and our sins and our lawless deeds will remember no more. Through faith, we receive all of your finished works for us on the cross, and we take the communion, and we receive this communion until you come again, in Jesus' name.
Amen. Amen. Can we now have prayer? We have Bumi, who's leading us in prayer. So Bumi, if you can unmute yourself.
Yes, sir.
Okay, all right. So you can pray.
Dear Father, we humbly come before you with grateful hearts, praising you with all our being. For we know that every good and perfect gift comes from you, the one who never changes. No matter what changes around us, you are ever the same. Thank you, Father, for this glorious day, for your divine protection that keeps us and also sustains our family and loved ones. Mm. We thank you for your unconditional and never-failing love that gives us grace every single day. For in your mercy, kindness, and love, we have been blessed in ways beyond recognition.
Yes, Lord.
Today, Lord, we want to recognize all your blessings, both large and small. So we say, Lord, that we are thankful for the roof over our head, your guard over all of us, the opportunities that you have created that we are unaware of, the near accident experiences that you have prevented, the food on our table, for also allowing us to enter a new season, bridging the gap in times of need, and the plans that you have over every single one of us, and much more. We are indeed grateful.
Thank you, Lord.
Thank you for the immeasurable riches through your grace, your forgiveness, love, peace, and joy.
Thank you, Lord.
Thank you for what you have done and what you are doing. We also recognize our forgetfulness in giving thanks to you, Lord. Please forgive us for when we have been ungrateful, and help us to change our perspective to see how truly blessed we are.
Yes, Lord.
To focus on what we have and not what we do not have. And in doing so, we will recognize how blessed we are. This past 1 year has reminded us how fragile life is and also how strong we can be. We recognize the evidence of your goodness for all those tough days that has passed us and that you have kept us. May we continue to trust that all evil will be made good by you.
Amen.
As we give thanks, we pray for all those who are seeking and waiting upon you when all hope seems lost. Keep their faith strong as they wait to leave. Let your goodness flow throughout our hearts as we reach out to one another. We also want to say thank you to our leaders, teachers, and all those. Sorry, we want to say thank you for our leaders, teachers, and all those who are working relentlessly and selflessly in the service of others. Thank you for the guidance that we have received and for granting them the heart to commit themselves. We are thankful, Father. Please receive our thanks in the mighty name of Jesus.
Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Thank you, Lord. And so, and for those who of us who are waiting, we need an advice, because waiting is not easy. Let us listen to an advice for those of us who are still waiting.
Okay, so something that I've noticed that I do when I'm trying to wait well is I manipulate situations and I try to speed up the process. And you talked a little earlier about how we need to go through the process in order to see the promise fulfilled. But what's one practical step that we can take when we're waiting for something to happen that can help us turn it right side up?
Oh, this is hard.
It is hard.
This is one I'd love someone else's advice on. I'll be honest. I'm a finisher, a completer.
Right.
I like things organized and tidy, and I want things done, and I want them done now, and I want immediate relief from my pain. And I think what's so hard about waiting, especially when we're waiting for something like a promise fulfilled by God, is that there's pain while we wait.
Yeah.
it's not just a matter of a timeline. It's a matter of relief that we want, right?
Yes.
And so one thing I want to challenge you with today, and it's something I have to challenge myself with, is I don't like pain very much. And so I want to relieve the pain. Mm-hmm. And so if I have a headache, I want to take Advil.
Yes.
If I stub my toe, I want to get the Neosporin that has the pain relief
yes.
in it and mm-hmm. then put the Band-Aid on it, right? And so I want the pain to go away. But what I have to remember is that there's even a process to the pain going away. Pain is often an indication that something needs to be healed and a healing needs to take place, and we can't rush that. But in order to know how we need to heal, we often need to be able to feel the pain. Mm-hmm. And so while we're waiting, I just want to encourage you, don't get sucked into the trap of numbing your pain. Mm-hmm. There are so many things that the enemy is going to put in front of you to tempt you to numb that pain. But if you don't ever feel the pain, you can't deal with the pain. And if you never really deal with the pain, you will never heal from the pain. And numbing can come in so many different aspects. We can get on Facebook and try to just distract ourselves, getting wrapped up in other people's lives.
Social media is a really
or Instagram,
sure.
mm-hmm. you know, just getting kind of caught up in everyone else's life to ignore some realities in our life. We can try to numb our pain with Netflix, you know, just watching movies or getting swept up in a TV series and we just watch them back to back to back, you know. Now, I'm not saying like, oh, shoot, you just did that yesterday, so that means you're
right.
numbing some pain. But I'm
right.
saying, be honest with yourself. Why are you doing it, mm-hmm. you know? If it's for entertainment, then that's a different category. But if it's to numb some pain in your life, pay attention to that. People can use alcohol to numb their pain. They use drugs to numb their pain. And oftentimes, we take the method of our numbing and we hold it as a secret. And yes. it's something that we just want to get through this season, and then we think we're going to release mm-hmm. that method of numbing. The reality is that method of numbing often sticks with us mm-hmm. and often prevents us really from dealing with the pain and healing from the pain. So be honest about that. And I would find a good friend, a safe friend, a friend that you know is praying more words for you than they talk about you or to you. And I would maybe just set up a conversation with that person, go have coffee with them or whatever, and just say, hey, help me process this. I think I am numbing my pain. Will you help me figure out one positive step I can take to let go of that numbing mechanism so that I can really deal with this pain? Because my goal is I want to heal from the pain.
And then they can help hold you accountable so you're not doing it alone.
That's right. And obviously, another great resource is good Christian counseling.
Yeah.
I can't say enough. I don't know why in the Christian community we have an aversion to saying we're in therapy or going to counseling or whatever. But you and I were talking earlier. It's like we love counseling.
Oh, yeah, I'm a big fan of counseling.
This is great. And so just like we are physical beings, we go to a medical doctor for that. We are spiritual beings. We go to Bible teachers to help our spiritual development. We're also emotional beings, and we can go to good, trained Christian counselors to help us. And certainly, if you need some resources on Christian counseling, we'll link some opportunities for you today.
Absolutely. Well, thank you so much, Lisa.
And if we are still waiting, we end the service with this.
Champion's not dead, he is alive. Oh, and he already
thank you, our Father, because you are indeed a God of miracles. And as we close, let's have the closing prayer. Father, in the name of Jesus, we come before your throne of grace. We thank you for today. We thank you for all that we have heard. We thank you for that which has ministered to our hearts. We thank you for that which we knew, but you had to remind us again. We thank you for that which is new, that we have never looked at, like we have seen this morning. We thank you for the prayers that reminds us of your faithfulness and encourages us of our tomorrow. We thank you, Father, for all and every aspect of what we have just gone through in the last hour or so. As we go, Lord, we just want to, in particular, bring Judy to you. And we want to speak health and strength, that she will find you and know you and stay with you. That you will help her as she's recovering in hospital. That she will be indeed a success story of yours. Father, we ask that you will be her rescue story. That she will find you in a way that she never thought she could. And that she will be a success. Father God, we just thank you. And we speak, oh Lord, that you surround her and you remove every manner of things that will seek to influence her away from that which you have said before her. We thank you, Father, because concerning her, we will testify of your goodness. And so, Lord, we just commit ourselves and each and every one of us to you, Lord. And we ask, oh Lord God, that you keep us through this week, in our going out, in our coming in. When we are aware, or when we are conscious, or when we are sleeping, when we are not aware of even our surroundings, and you are. Our confidence, oh Lord, is that we have a Father who does not sleep, does not go weary, does not slumber. And so, Lord, we just place this week. Surprise us in where you will turn up. Surprise us in what you will do. Surprise us in the way you will speak to us, in what you will show us. Surprise us in a good way, because you are a good God, and we have seen enough evidence of your goodness. Thank you, Father. Thank you, Jesus, for being our rescue story. Thank you that you will, even for sometimes when you don't believe, you will help our unbelief. And you will give us a new and a stronger confidence in your word. This we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Maybe I actually say the grace together, if you unmute yourselves. Let us go in peace with thanksgiving. May the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ,
Christ,
love of God,
and the love of God,
and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit, be with us now and forevermore. Amen. Surely, goodness and mercy shall follow us all the days of our lives, And we shall dwell in the house of the Lord forever and ever.
Amen.
Amen. Well, somebody was 80 this week. And unfortunately, she can't see it, but we can see her picture, her smile, and a massive cake right in front of her, and a wonderful tea setting there. Well done. Well, we are, yes. So Kathleen was 80 on Friday, and Pat and Tony and Yinka and Kathy and all were all there to help to celebrate with her. In the garden, in Tony and Pat's garden, which was quite lovely. And so we have a picture here. I'm sure we're going to print this picture for her so she can have a picture of her celebration. So we just thank God. So let us think, happy birthday. Is there any other person whose birthday it is this week that we missed? Oh, okay. Mm-hmm. So let us together sing happy birthday to Kathleen. Thank God for your life, and we pray that health and strength will be yours, that you will experience the kind of health and well-being that you have not even experienced for many years, that Amen. God will show you his faithfulness, that God will show you that he's still a God of miracles.
Amen.
And I speak wonderful things for you, and Amen. That the years and the days ahead will be more joyful than the years of the past.
Amen.
New and exciting things in your life will come, and Amen. You will give testimony of the goodness of the Lord.
Amen.
It's not over Amen. Yet. God has just begun, and Amen. You will see his goodness in Jesus' name.
Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Amen. Right.
Amen. Amen.
So, lovely, nice seeing everybody.
Hello, everybody.
Hello.
Hello.
Thank you for all those who are.
Hello.
Yes, yes. And look forward to speaking to you. Actually, yes, there's no midweek this Wednesday. We'll have it. We'll have your pastor is busy.
Doing what? And what about our pastor's wife?
Our pastor's wife will have a time off as well. Our pastor's wife is always busy. If I'm busy, she's been double busy. So, yes.
Well, you can tell them what you're doing. You're learning some technical stuff on Zoom and what was it again? Digital church where you go back to real church or something like that.
Yes. How do we continue? How do we work out? Because we are going back. Right, we're talking about going back. We are going back. When is the hall open? Is it in May?
The hall is already open, right. But I think based on government regulation, mm-hmm. we can only meet, a group of our size can only meet after the 17th of May. Okay. So the hall is already open for mm-hmm. us. The different regulations allow people to meet. Mm-hmm. So we can meet the 17th of May. Mm-hmm. And actually, they're waiting for us to confirm all the times, and we've all been waiting for you to to say what time you're ready.
Yeah. Well, the question is this, right? The question is this, which I'll leave with you guys. I don't want to. What I'm afraid of in at least in May, maybe by at least first Sunday of June, I can see that that's possible. But if we're going to have a church in May, I don't want to have a service where I and my wife, Antonia and Pat, are the only ones there. And the rest of you still, and the rest of you on Zoom in your pajamas and whatever, and watching and waving to girls.
Yeah. That's true.
So that's why I'm being very reluctant to go and set up the whole church, and the rest of you are very happily seeing us on Zoom, because the truth of the matter is that we will always continue with Zoom, because there are some people who live further away from us who might not be able to get to church, or who for some reason or for good reasons cannot make church on that day. So we will always, one thing that lockdown has done is brought us to a place where we recognize that we have to have a service that is beyond just the immediate people in a physical
place. Beyond four walls.
Yes. So we will always have some kind of digital live service going forward. But I don't want us to substitute that for the fellowship of brethren when we can be there. I'm not saying you should drive thousands of miles to come to such service, but there are certain times when we can say, I'll just join it on Zoom. That's very easily done. And I want us to be aware of that. So we'll decide, maybe by next week, you guys think about it too. Let me know how excited you are to go back, and then we'll then take it from there. But for sure, we will do our next Thanksgiving service in church.
Amen.
Yeah. So our next Thanksgiving service will be in church. So the first Sunday of June.
Okay.
However, if we're going to go in before then, I need to be persuaded and convinced that you will turn up.
I will turn up.
Okay.
We will show up.
Okay.
We have to do a register.
You mark the register. Okay. Well. I'm getting encouraged. So we may
that
have.
First,
go on.
That first Sunday in June, does that include bring and share or?
Yeah. It is a big. No, it's a proper bring and share stuff. Yeah. It's a normal service. So, yeah, we should eat together. We should, and hopefully the weather will be open. We can open all the doors and do whatever. We should actually try and
have fellowship together.
If we can, yeah.
Yeah, the first Sunday in June is fine for opening up. It's subsequent ones that we have to think about.
Yes.
What do you mean subsequent ones? You don't want
every
to
Sunday. Every Sunday one that we have to think about. Like Pastor said, he doesn't want it to be like himself is there, his wife is there, Tony and Pat are there, and every other person is waving at him from Zoom. Why can't he be at home on Zoom then? You know? So let us pray about it. Let us think about it.
We really need to think about that. I mean, what she's saying is good. We really need to think about it and saying, actually, what have we learned and what is the benefit going forward from this lockdown?
Yeah.
There's a benefit to it, and there's something to about it. Because I can see what will happen. I can see the fact where, yes, you will not be able to make church, and you are thinking to yourself, if I go on Zoom now, they'll say, and then you don't go on Zoom. Because you're thinking, oh no, I was on Zoom last week, I'm on Zoom this week, they're going to think, what's going on? Now,
yeah,
we all know we're going to be on Zoom. Let's be on Zoom.
Yeah.
And if we all know we're going to be in church, let's be in church.
I think people appreciate the actual being together.
Yeah.
Yes, I know. Yeah. But...
Well, maybe we can do the first... Maybe we can be doing our Thanksgiving together once everything is opened up. Because I know that there are some people in the community that actually miss the coming together of the church. Of the body, and we have to do the physical meeting for them too, for everybody.
I'm happy to be in church every Sunday. I have no problem with that. I'm happy to do that, but what I'm reluctant about is to do that. because it takes a lot of effort to put everything out. That's especially right. If nobody comes, you put everything out and you have
and
to...
And then you put everything back.
You have to put everything back by yourself.
Yeah.
So that bit is what I'm... If there is a number that will be there that we feel, okay, yeah, I'm not saying everybody must be there, who whatever, but if there's a number that will be there, then if then that's fine. So I'm happy for us to have church every Sunday. But if it turns out that it's only going to be 5 people there or 2 people there, then I think we're better off on Zoom. That's a better value for my time too, and your time. New people might come, and if new people start coming, that's fine. But I'm being very, very honest, right? You see, I have to start pacing myself as well. And I realize that, yes, if I'm going to pace myself, there are no young people coming to collect the key to set up.
Exactly.
If there are young people coming in, they come in, they collect the key, they go and set up, and that's then fine. You know, you remember many, for those of you who have not been here for a long time, for many, many years ago, Tony used to be head of logistics. When he grew older.
When he grew older,
he passed out, he handed the baton. So
I retired.
But if the younger people are coming across from behind and taking over, well, fine. No, me too. I'm getting to that age now where my back is telling me that I need to be take it easy. So I don't want to be setting up.
100%.
And I'm ready to sacrifice that if people will be there. Because let's not decide. I don't want any suggestion now. I want you to think about it. I want you to understand my conversation and then go and think about it. And then think about it. And nothing is the wrong thing. But let us agree what it is. Is the wrong thing. If we have Zoom twice a month, that's fine. There's nothing wrong about it. But let us go and think about it and accept it and know. And new people will also join us on Zoom from all over the world as well. So that's fine. But let's think about it and see what we come up with. Pray, think about it, and then we'll take it from there. Okay? All right.
Okay.
Au revoir.
All right. Bye.
Have a blessed week.
Thank you. Everybody.
Have a blessed week.
Bye.
Thank you.
Bye.
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 Bye.